Hello, and welcome to another edition of Cine 104, History of Motion Pictures, 1945 up to the present. This is Class 10, and we are up into the late 70s and early 1980s, and we've got a couple of classic directors in store today, Ridley Scott and Martin Scorsese, and so let's start off. Ridley Scott, he is British, and he began in advertising, and that might give some sort of an indication as to why his films look so great. Advertising is very visual or very image conscious, and Ridley's films, even the ones that perhaps aren't so good, look fantastic. Just the lighting and the cinematography and all of that, they always look really nice to me. And these two films, to start off with, Alien and Blade Runner, are known a lot for their look. The alien in Alien, and there he is really the prototype for all sorts of aliens that are going to come after this. Lots of teeth and sort of this gloopy, gloppy, mucousy sort of stuff coming out of his mouth. And 1979... we did not have CGI yet. That's a good 15 years into the future. And Ridley Scott knew that if he wasn't careful, that his alien was going to look just like it was, a tall, thin, skinny man in a rubber suit. And that's the way movies looked in the 1950s, those nice low-budget drive-in movies, black-and-white drive-in movies. They would patch together whatever kind of a look and effects that they could. And often they looked cheesy and cheap, and people maybe didn't care so much. But the alien in Alien is barely seen. This is the best look you're going to see of the alien. A nice freeze frame or a nice photo of the guy. But in the movie, we can't really tell. There are lots of very fast edits. There is strobe going on, strobe lighting going on, a lot of it. Lots of darkness. Lots of smoke and steam and dust and sand and all that. So we're barely going to see the alien. It's on screen, very similarly to the shark in Jaws, somewhere around 2 minutes or so. And there's a longer shot of the head, which wasn't the guy at all, but sort of a model thing. And the alien was designed conceptually by Swiss artist H.R. Giger, as it's pronounced, and full of lots of very disturbing sorts of imagery, body parts, sexual body parts, let's say, and it's toned down, of course, for the movie, but yeah, there's lots of that sort of imagery floating through his work, and it is really disturbing stuff. I'm sure you can go on to Google Images and stuff and see other H.R. Giger stuff. And over the years, they've sort of tweaked the look of the alien in the sequel to the sequel and the prequel to the sequel to the whatever and Alien versus Predator and all that. So I guess nobody wants to sort of just say, well, this is good enough. This is fine. Why do we have to change what isn't broken, but everybody seems to want to have to do that. So this story here is about a long-haul transport spaceship, okay? And I always liken it to a modern-day oil tanker. And modern-day oil tankers, they're gigantic. They're as big as multiple football fields. They have a relatively small crew. I don't know how many, maybe a dozen or something, but not very many. And they are just hauling, usually oil, I'm sure other things, across the ocean. And they are not, for the most part, military. They're not, for the most part, scientific. And that's what this crew on the Nostromo is. And the Nostromo, by the way, is a name taken from a book that actually inspired Apocalypse Now, set in Africa. So, okay. There's a leap and a leap and another leap, but anyway, that was the Nostromo in Heart of Darkness, and that is the name of this ship, and this poor crew is going to be unwantedly, I guess, not wanting to be part of another trope in mysteries and thrillers called Ten Little Indians. There was an Agatha Christie story book called Ten Little Indians, and now it's a trope. So if you look, if you watch the movie and you look up tropes, you might come up with that. And basically, from the nursery rhyme, Ten Little, Nine Little, Eight Little Indians, the people are killed off one by one until there is one person left standing. And so that is used in many films, and it's used in this one too. The sequel by James Cameron is a completely different sort of a film. I recommend that one too. James Cameron's a great filmmaker. It's a completely different movie. That one is more with a... a group, I guess, of a platoon, maybe, of Marines, and they are loaded with all sorts of guns and weapons and all that kind of stuff, and they are going specifically to do battle with the aliens. So that's kind of like a war movie or an Indians attacking the fort sort of a thing. I hate to I keep picking on that, but those are old movies, Indians and Native Americans. Attacking the fort, being under attack, a war movie. But back to Alien, the haunted house, Ten Little Indians sort of a film, and they are sent a signal that awakens them from hypersleep. And or hibernation, and so they are barely halfway home. They are directed to go down to the planet where the signal is being sent. And while most of them are out there, there's two of them left back on the ship. And our final heroine there, Sigourney Weaver, kind of a science officer, discovers that possibly the signal is a warning and not a distress call. And she tries to put a halt to the whole thing, and she doesn't want any unknown alien organisms allowed back into the ship. But of course she's overruled, otherwise we wouldn't have much of a movie. Ridley, again, very careful not to let us see too much of this man in the alien suit. Now today with CGI, they can do all sorts of amazing things, but not in 1979, and it's a really, really good movie that holds up quite well. Those of you who are used to the modern CGI era will not have any problem watching this film. You'll enjoy it. It's very well done, and I don't think you're going to come away thinking, boy, those special effects were cheesy and they're not as good as today. Of course they're not as good as today, but they look pretty good. This is, what, 40 plus years ago. So yeah, it holds up quite well. And so they are going to go to this ship, which is a big model sitting on a table to be filmed. So Ridley Scott is very careful to have lots of wind and dust and stuff in the air and fast editing and things like that. When they get into the ship, they are going to see another alien, basically. It's an intelligent alien that could build spaceships and pilot spaceships. These aliens that we're seeing right here are, at least in the second film by James Cameron, almost like insects. We see a queen laying eggs. So like bees or like ants or something like that, they're almost like some sort of a insect type of creature. Or possibly a reptile, maybe. Alligators, I think, have eggs, things like that. And as the movies go on, they give away more and more backstory and stuff. And I think our imaginations are pretty good, and they do fill in lots of blanks and things. Of course, we have questions in our minds, but sometimes it's best to have a little mystery, I think. But so this contingent of these haulers, these, I guess they're astronauts of a sort, and they go into the giant spaceship there where the signal is coming from, and inside they find another alien, actually the first alien they encounter, and he's sitting here, either that's a telescope or a gun, it's hard to tell, probably a telescope. He's dead. He's got a hole sort of there, and he's quite big as compared to humans. He's quite a bit bigger. And we also see some of Giger's interesting. It almost looks like the walls are made out of bones. And that is his biomechanical look. And this guy has been dubbed the space jockey online for various reasons. And so, again, this is a really great-looking film, which has changed maybe just a little bit as the films go by. And one of our crew members is going to find another area where there are thousands of eggs. These sets are really amazing. They really are. He's going to find thousands and thousands of eggs. They're going to lower him down by some sort of a rope or wire or something like that. And one of them is going to burst forth, and he's looking at it very closely. That's what you have to do if you're in a horror thriller type movie. You can't stand back and poke at it with a stick. You gotta put your hand right in it or your face right in it. That's a wonderful trope, and he does. And for his inquisitiveness, this is what he gets, okay? The face hugger, and it is looks to be keeping him alive. When they try to cut it off, this blood acid squirts out, and they figure out it's probably a defense mechanism because the blood burns a hole through a couple of layers of the ship's hull. It's very, very strong acid. And as the series goes on, we find that these creatures, these aliens, quite possibly are some sort of a biological weapon that were created by the space jockey alien. Thus, the acid blood and being able to survive practically in a vacuum and all the whole rest of it. Anyway, I've linked to the trailer, the space jockey, the eggs, acid blood, and the chest burster scenes. They're all really classic scenes, and enjoy. And what I would do right now is I would stop this video and go watch all of the Alien links and then come back, and then we will dive into Blade Runner. Okay, so Blade Runner from 1982, just 3 years later, sci-fi by way of film noir, and we can kind of tell here there is one of our replicants. I almost blanked on the name. There's so many names for robots and replicants and cyborgs and all of that. In this film, they're called replicants. That's Rachel. And she is in this retro future. There she is smoking a cigarette, just like in the 1940s, just like in film noir. She's very much the femme fatale. There are ceiling fans. There are trench coats. There's all sorts of wonderful imagery to make us think of film noir, except we have flying cars and replicants and things like that. So it's a wonderful, wonderful mishmash. We will talk about the author of the book in just a little bit. His name is Philip K. Dick, and he's the guy that wrote this and many other classic sci-fi books that have been turned into films. Some imagery from the film. There's Harrison Ford, kind of in a trench coat, for 1982, that was kind of a different look. A lot of men in the early 80s had longer hair and different sorts of clothes and coloring and all that. And Ridley wanted to have him wear a nice fedora, just like they did in the 1940s, but he had already made Indiana Jones. And so he was kind of upset that he couldn't put Harrison Ford in a hat. But otherwise, kind of echoing back, sort of futuristic and sort of retro in this future city. And above we see some of the new stuff, sort of pyramid-like at the big company that is behind the replicants. And Harrison Ford is walking through the streets of L.A. Remember, from 1982 to 2019 is 37, 38 years into the future. Now it's in the past, and we still don't have flying cars. And luckily, we don't have acid rain. So in this future, we see a lot of the old buildings from L.A. from through the 20th century, and it's there's a wonderful tour that you can take. There's a really cool building that they used for some sets in the movie called the Bradbury Building. And if you go into the Bradbury Building, they have a plaque commemorating the fact that they shot Blade Runner there. And the Bradbury Building was built around 1900. And there are some other places in downtown LA that were built throughout the 20th century. And then we see the really modern stuff. And that's because Ridley thought that the future should sort of look like a built-up city, just like cities of today. If you go to an old city like London, you're going to find stuff there that is hundreds and hundreds of years old, and then you're going to find some really modern looking stuff. And so Ridley wanted his LA of 2019 to look sort of like it was built up, and there's some really modern stuff and some older stuff throughout the city. So kind of a nice choice. Some of the stuff in the film is a little hard to figure out. And unless you sort of geek out on it like I have and read the book and get the four DVD pack and all of that and read the making of book and all that kind of stuff. And you can probably figure it out. But just in case, as we dive in and you start looking at it, and some of the stuff was covered in the voiceover where he says, "my ex-wife," and so on. And otherwise, we don't really know that he was ever married or had an ex-wife. And in the sequel, Blade Runner 2049, it does explain that the rain is a kind of an acid rain. We also know that a lot of people are, everybody who can get off Earth has left Earth and gone off world. And the only people really left on Earth, there's some policemen, and what looked to be poor people, immigrants, sick, people that can't afford or aren't healthy enough somehow to go off world. So Earth is in this ecological, catastrophic area there. Arid places where it never rains, and acid rain, and all that kind of stuff. And some of that is the stuff that was changed in the ending. So it revolves around these replicants, and back when we talked about the stages of genre films, and we talked about Frankenstein and so on, I mentioned that what used to be beings built from dead bodies today would be some sort of robot or replicant or android or cyborg or whatever the heck you want to call them. And that leaves us open to lots and lots of philosophical thoughts of, do they have a soul? If they're killed, are they murdered? In this movie, they're retired. In this movie, they're retired. He's not considered a killer when he puts out of action these replicants that are causing havoc. They have escaped from a spaceship. They are on Earth. They want to meet their maker at the Tyrell Corporation, and they are on a sort of a rampage, and he is a Blade Runner sent to, pulled out of retirement. The Harrison Ford's character is pulled out of retirement and he's going to go track these down, and he's going to find out that this beautiful young lady, who doesn't even know that she's a replicant, isn't replicant. That's only spoiled maybe 15 minutes into the movie, so not too much there. Rachel, played by Sean Young. So, scientists playing God, creating life in a lab. Are they slaves? All that stuff's there. It runs through this one. It runs even more through Blade Runner 2049 and Edward Scissorhands even, and Ex Machina and Westworld on HBO. So a lot of stuff, a lot of great sci-fi philosophical stuff brought up from this movie and the script and the book that it was based on and all of that. So this is one of the very first films to have a director's cut. Ridley dropped the voiceover, as I mentioned, the voiceover is gone. The ending was changed, and that's a good thing because the ending of the original U.S. version of the movie doesn't make a whole lot of sense. The survivors are driving what looks to be up the coast through Northern California or Oregon or Washington with pine trees and moss and ferns and all of that. And if Earth is in this ecological disaster with acid rain and all that, it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. On the other hand, unbeknownst to everybody on the planet, except for Ridley Scott himself, he has decided that Harrison Ford is also a replicant. It's not that way in the book. It's not that way in the script. Harrison Ford didn't like that, but Ridley decided that he would make some clues, some very minor clues, but a couple of clues pointing to the possibility, the strong likelihood that Harrison Ford's character is a replicant. Throughout the movie, the actual replicants, their eyes have this little glow thing that they did with mirrors and things like that. And who knows? You can jump on one side of the debate or the other on all that. I'm sort of on the he's not side, mainly because most of the people left on Earth are kind of sleepwalking through life. They're kind of losers, really. They're kind of losers for the most part, and kind of just sleepwalking through life. And the replicants, they want to know why they have why they're trying to be killed and why they will shut down after being active for 4 years or so, and that's all explained, that for the sake of their psychology, they needed to have some sort of a backstory, some sort of a life as childhood and all that kind of stuff. Otherwise, they would be psychologically damaged. So there are implanted memories in them, and that is one of the themes of Philip K. Dick with false memories or implanted memories and that sort of thing. All right, speaking of Philip K. Dick, and there he is with Ridley Scott. He died that year, 1982, one of the all-time great sci-fi writers, implanted or false memories, and he is quite successful, or his estate is very successful, because all of these films and franchises have been based on Philip K. Dick stories or novels. Blade Runner, sequel to Blade Runner, Total Recall, and the remake of Total Recall, the one with Arnold Schwarzenegger and another one with Colin Farrell, Minority Report, the Steven Spielberg film, Paycheck. If you can track that down, it's pretty good. Anything done by Philip K. Dick is actually pretty good. Ben Affleck is in that one. Scanner Darkly is very interesting, set in Orange County. The Adjustment Bureau with Matt Damon is based on his stuff. And The Man in the High Castle, which concluded, I think, 3 seasons on Amazon TV. Kind of a speculative fiction. What if the Nazis and the Imperial Japan had won World War II, and he won lots of awards for that. So anyway, it's pretty amazing stuff, all since he died. So, yes, dead and successful. He apparently he got to see an early cut of the film in 1982, and that's when he passed away. Back to Ridley Scott. Ridley's, if you can figure that out, Ridley's on the left, Phillips on the right in that. Back to Ridley Scott, and some of his films, Thelma and Louise, Gladiator, in which he won the Best Picture Oscar, but he did not personally win the Best Director, Black Hawk Down, American Gangster, The Martian. He is still making films. He's still active. He's deep into his 80s. We have a number of filmmakers. Woody Allen is in his 80s. Clint Eastwood is in his 80s. Seems to me that Martin Scorsese's pushing 80. And I don't know, maybe we get better health or better nutrition or something. But that's a pretty good career to be really making these big budget movies into your 80s. So good for all those guys, that's for sure. Okay, so now go and look at some Blade Runner. I've got the trailer and a few other scenes, Rachel's scene, which is quite nice. And we will talk a little bit about Blade Runner 2049 when we get up into CGI later on. All right, so we're going to stay in the 80s, but take a completely different subject matter, high school kids. And John Hughes, there he is. He's the older guy in the lower right. And he made a number of films in the 1980s. People love him. People that are directors that came up in that era really love John Hughes. He wasn't an Oscar winner. He's not one of these sort of legendary Spielberg, Ridley Scott, Scorsese kind of guys. But he's pretty influential. And so what the heck? I wanted to put him in the class, even though he's not one of these big favorites with the Academy members and all that sort of thing. And he had a pretty good run of films, 16 Candles, Weird Science. A lot of these people appear in various versions of his various films and stuff. I have linked to Ferris Bueller's Day Off, my personal favorite of this group, with Matthew Broderick breaking the fourth wall. So you can enjoy Matthew Broderick breaking the fourth wall, Ferris Bueller. And Home Alone, not set in high school and not quite in the 1980s, but his biggest hit by a long shot. And he was a writer, producer, director, so he didn't always direct his movies. Sometimes he wrote it and counted on other directors to make it come alive. He probably took part in the casting and that sort of thing. So they do have kind of a John Hughes feel to them, even though he wasn't the director of all of them. But he did direct Ferris Bueller's Day Off. So you can enjoy that and then come back. And we have Robert Zemeckis, the director, and he is a user of CGI. This film right here, Who Framed Roger Rabbit, is not CGI. It's ink and paint. It's ink and paint, but a big hit for him. He did Romancing the Stone and the sequel to that, which is Michael Douglas, kind of a modern-day Indiana Jones, sort of an explorer, but we have some romance and things like that mixed in, and a pretty good-sized hit. Back to the Future and two sequels, which were shot actually simultaneously and then released about 6 months apart. And Forrest Gump, in which he won the Best Picture and Best Director and Best Actor for Tom Hanks. But I want to zoom in on this film here, Who Framed Roger Rabbit. And there are such strong allegorical elements in it, and I guess that's what draws me to it. The Toons are really stand-ins for blacks. They are segregated. They're sort of in a ghetto. Toontown is a sort of a ghetto. They live in a segregated society, just like America was, certainly in the South, in the 1940s and 1950s. This movie's set in the 1940s. They are allowed to perform and serve, but not allowed to be in the audience at the Ink and Paint Club, where Jessica is a performer. And that is very much what segregation was like. All sorts of very talented African-Americans could perform in nightclubs and things like that. Audience in some of, not every single one. I don't know specifically about Vegas. I know that Sammy Davis Jr., who was a big star in Las Vegas, wasn't allowed to stay in the hotel attached to the casino. So there are some very strong elements of that running through. The Ink and Paint Club, when goes in to the Ink and Paint Club, it's sort of like a speakeasy, in that he goes down an alley, he knocks on the door, and gives a password before he's allowed in. So that more relates to the Prohibition era of Prohibition was 1919 to 1934. So that wouldn't have been needed in the 1940s, but what the heck, it's kind of fun. And he goes in. And inside, he sees Toons on stage, and the first Toons on stage are Donald Duck and Daffy Duck. Yes, one from Warner Brothers and one from Disney. And it was amazing that they managed to get the rights to, you know, Mickey Mouse and Bugs Bunny, right, on both sides of the spectrum, and a few others too. Betty Boop's in there, and a few other characters. But getting Warner Brothers cartoon characters, which are pretty famous. I think they've done probably better than Disney with a lot of their characters, like Bugs Bunny and Daffy Duck and all that. And didn't let them go out onto Saturday TV and all that other kind of stuff. And that is a big reason why there were no sequels, because they were just driving a huge negotiations and things. It's very hard. They're driving a very hard bargain. They were sitting there counting words, counting, I don't know, syllables, counting seconds and frames of film. Is Mickey on screen exactly as long as Bugs is on screen? Is Daffy and Donald, right? So it really was hard. It's hard to make a really good movie when you're counting seconds and frames and things like that. So this is a big hit, really big hit. And I think a lot of people were thinking, where's the sequel? And that was it, really, the negotiations and stuff. They just constantly broke down. Disney somehow, I don't know what, but somehow they got the rights to do Toontown. Although in Toontown, we're going to see Roger and Jessica and so on, but we wouldn't see Bugs Bunny or Daffy Duck. At least I don't think so. I haven't been to Toontown lately. So that is... Who Framed Roger Rabbit, and a lot of fun. It's really a lot of fun. And there is kind of the dark side, right, about segregation and all that. So the next time you watch the movie, or if you choose to watch the movie for your paper, you can think a little bit about that. And hopefully when you do some research, they will talk about that a little bit. It also has a similar plot outline to Chinatown, of all things, in that in Chinatown, set in the 1930s, Jack Nicholson's character is investigating some use of, it turns out, some mysterious people with insider knowledge know that water is coming through the California Aqueduct all the way down to Southern California. And land that would not be very good farmland, like the San Fernando Valley, is going to be good farmland. So they are secretly buying up thousands of acres of land because they have inside knowledge as to how that's going to come down. In this film, the freeways are coming through, and there are some jokes about L.A. having really wonderful mass transit, the red trolley cars and things like that. And we see the Bob Hoskins character riding the red car, I think it's called the red car, around. And those tracks were, for the most part, all torn up and the freeways put in and all that. And then it wasn't until we get into the 1980s or 90s before we finally get our own mass transit, blue line, red line, all that. And so in this film, the bad people want to buy up Toontown so that they can get rich where the freeways are going to come through. And there's actually a couple of westerns, Destry Rides Again and Once Upon a Time in the West, that also deal with that same theme, that if people know where the trains are going to come through, they can buy up some of that land and get rich, because where trains and especially stations are going to be, they will be valuable as well. So kind of a trope of a plot that they use in this film. And some LA history, some social history there with blacks and segregation and all of that. Very interesting. Zemeckis was an early adopter of 3D and IMAX and motion capture, and we will talk about that when we get into CGI and all that, but he and his Polar Express was a very, very early 3D IMAX motion capture film, and so a number of his other films use interesting CGI. Forrest Gump, for the most part, sort of inserting Forrest into some scenes. He gets to meet. He's this very interesting character. A low IQ, which is pointed out and identified in the movie. And he meets Elvis Presley, and he meets President Nixon, and President Kennedy, and President Johnson, and Abbie Hoffman, and the war, and Vietnam, all that. So he sort of leads this amazing life, meeting lots and lots of people who are historically famous during that era. And Forrest seems to, you know, if something's going on, you know, he's part of it, the jogging craze or whatever. And in this new history, he's the guy that develops the smiley face and lots of stuff like that. He's telling the story. We have a framing device where he's sitting on a park bench and he's talking to the people that are sitting there with him waiting for the bus. And he is a unreliable narrator, and in large part because of his low IQ. But he's treated very, very nicely throughout the movie, really. But we in the audience are privy to insider knowledge that when he says that his friend invested some of Forrest's money in a fruit company, and we find out that that fruit company is Apple. And so he's going to get rich off of his stocks and things like that. So again, he's an unreliable narrator, and we're going to know about some of that inside information of Forrest and the stories that he's going to be telling us and so on. So enjoy all of that. They are both fun for the whole family. And if you want to watch something with the whole family, some of our movies like Alien and Blade Runner are R-rated. But for sure, John Hughes and Who Framed Roger Rabbit and Forrest Gump are really good for the whole family. So if you should pick one of those movies, gather around. They're really a lot of fun. And I think everybody will enjoy them. And you can show your knowledge about segregation and things like that. So there we go. History Motion Pictures, 1945 to present, class 10. And next time, we're going to start. I'm not exactly sure where we're going next time. Tune in and we'll find out. I know we're getting into the 80s and 90s, and I am going to be talking about some foreign film directors from France, from Brazil, from Mexico. So that is on the horizon. And tune in next time. See you then.